Good afternoon. I think I'm like my students. I mean, just feeling quite nervous and maybe just till the last minute preparing for exams, trying to see how do I say something in 18 minutes. So it was, I think, first of all, I would like to thank our students to give me an opportunity. I'm supposed to be saying something about silicon or electronics, but the essence of whatever I want to say today is just that the whole world is changing. We are in the age of Internet of Things or Internet of Everything, anything and everything connected. All our walks of our life, even the way we are going to live, the way we eat, way we dream, or even the dress we wear, which would monitor our, already some of the examples given, how it will monitor our life is going to change, and it is going to be controlled by electronics. Of course, most of it was done so far by silicon, but then things are changing. Unfortunately or fortunately, India has been a key enabler in this change of life. Embedded systems which enable every walk of our life or every aspect of electronics is actually enabled or maybe predominantly done in India, like Intel inside in every product. Like they said of computers, every product in this world today has some aspect of design or embedded done in India. But unfortunately, I mean, our education system and our ecosystem was such that though we were doing the brain for most products in the world, from aerospace to agriculture, photocopier to scanner printer to PET scan to whatever, unfortunately, we don't fabricate integrated circuits. I mean, silicon is a key enabler, but then suddenly the world is changing. So in the next, maybe, I mean, say 15 minutes or so, I would like to just maybe sort of rush through a few things to say that we don't have to say that currently our semiconductor technology capability is so good that we are just about 15 generations behind the world and that we will never be able to catch up the way it is. But the emerging opportunities are such that maybe tomorrow we can do electronics in cottage industry with new materials, new devices, and that innovation can happen in, even in a university or even in a garage. And that is the type of opportunities that are coming up. And I just want to show, I mean, a brief glimpse of saying how we could do things even indigenously, and also maybe some of the things that I had personally an opportunity to create for the first time. So, I mean, thanks once again for... So I think I'll... So we have gone come a long way from valve electronics to, I think, say, current day electronics, where everything and anything is enabled by satellites. And today India has set up its IRNS satellite systems, which would enable us possibly to communicate without even international collaboration. Because I'm sure many people might be aware, when India was trying to test its, interceptor missile technology, I mean, everything was agreed with US maybe agencies, but fractionally for 10 seconds, the satellites did not work, and so the test failed. And that is when I think the government decided that they needed to accelerate their IRNSS technology. So satellites are a key enabler in the age of communication. And that, so everything is changing, and the whole world actually is very much, I think, say to is dependent on hope and aspiration. And that's what when Martin Luther's, and it has to be designed. Nothing is inevitable. And that there is always hope. I mean, this just says that there is hope. And so even if in semiconductor technology we haven't done much, maybe there is an opportunity for us to go beyond that. We are standing here in BML Munjal University, and we are talking of Make in India. We are talking of whole world looking at India's demographic dividend because we have the largest number of youth in the world. So I think I just want to at least acknowledge that this is BML Munjal University, named after maybe one of the pioneers of Indian industry who actually believed in Make in India. And that the university is also trying to do something which is sustainable and inclusive. And even electronics in that context has to, I'm not sure how many people know that, see, there are parts of Texas to part of, I mean, Glasgow, where because of the semiconductor industry and so many things dumped under the world, there are environmental hazards and issues which are not even seriously talked about. So thankfully, like say India, because of our obsolescence, maybe we are not in the technology regime, but we also escaped some of the problems. But there are huge opportunities now in future to do even electronics with sustainable materials. So the examples that I would give is just to show you that how it could be done. And so the university is also trying to put in a new pedagogy of education where practicing things are expected to be a key enabler. And we hope some of our students would be also engaged in doing electronics, which could happen in this age of connecting new devices, new materials with the type of infrastructure that we are creating. The whole world is today connected. Gone are the days when we had to have huge servers, huge equipment. Everything happens in the touch of a, finger, just by the touch of a finger. And if we were to look at electronics industry, because I mean we are talking of silicon, you see that just in the last 50 plus years, if things were to process or progress at the same speed as electronics progressed, I mean, say today we have actually already come to 7 nanometers. I mean, we have grown about 3,500 times in making integrated circuits. In terms of energy efficiency, we have grown 90,000 times. I mean, in terms of cost reduction, 60,000 times. Just a simple example, if the car industry were to progress at the same level, we should be running 3 lakh kilometers per hour. So it's an unimaginable, every billions, and we cannot even count how many components in this world or how many transistors are enabling our life. So that is the, I mean, mind-blowing opportunity that has happened with silicon. But then, as we said, India is nowhere in the picture. We do enable everything. And for the embedded system that we do, or the brain that we do, last year, $340 billion was a semiconductor industry. And for the $340 billion industry, we hardly got about $15 billion as revenue. We are doing the brain. Because we do not system integrate, we do not make full products and systems on our own. So that is where there's a unique opportunity for us to make simple devices, simple circuits, product solutions indigenously. And one of the examples, there is, and all this is because of emerging material science. And so we would like to show example of just one material as to what all can happen. Every aspect of our life is expected to be controlled. And this is just to emphasize that whatever new emerging technologies, even disruptive technologies, are supposed to be enabled by materials. So the need to look at emerging material. And from time immemorial, whether we like it or not, Asia was a leader. For just about 150 years, we were not there as a leaders, and global developed world was ahead. But once again, I mean, say India or Asia is expected to be a global leader. And that global leadership could be in service industry or in disruptive technology. So, I mean, like if you can look at it, say this shows something about service industry, and this is about new disruptive technology. In every aspect of technology, I think India is expected to be a leader. And and many of this, as we said, are expected to be enabled by new materials. And the government is planning many process and system to see that how do we leverage this digital economy for all our progress. We started off with money, I mean, and the cash aspects of technology and the problems that we are facing. And something else that is going to enable this technology, as I said, there are two things. Conventional silicon is enabling many aspects of our life, but then many things else are also happening beyond, which is called this large area and flexible microelectronics. Again, thankfully or wonderfully, we are oblivious to it. Our education system, it's a 200 billion industry we do not even teach. No, I mean, hardly a handful of Indian institutions teach about large area and flexible microelectronics, use of amorphous semiconductors, organic semiconductors, nanomaterials. And obviously, we do not manufacture anything. Now, some assembly is going to happen in the future. Government plans are there. But then can we, I mean, expect in the age of IoT when 50 billion or 80 trillion or maybe a trillion systems are connected in, we expect everything to be imported. So therefore, there's a huge need to look at new materials, new devices. And so these are just saying the type of things that are happening beyond silicon, where electronics could be in any shape and size, across all sorts of shape. And then also we could create new properties on any material, functionalities. I mean, I could have a ceramic and I could make it conducting. I could have a plastic, I could make it reflective, I could make it conductive, I could make it, then we can create metamaterials. So surface engineering is something emerging. So huge amount of opportunities with new materials. So from stone age to steel age to the current age of new emerging materials and composites from carbon-based material, materials have been the key for enabling transition of our life. And man's always, it has been enabled by material. But unfortunately, India as a leader has now lost that scope. I mean, even now we export our alloys to get back materials. We grind our waste and again send it internationally to bring back the waste from good material. But we don't fully process it to the final product. So therefore, we need to go back to our material capability, because most things from aerospace to agriculture, apparels to automobile, I mean, defense area, telecom, everything is going to be enabled in this new emerging domain by new materials. So what is the advantage of the current material science is that conventionally silicon, working with silicon was like having a mountain and cutting it down to small pieces and making things happen. or I'm sure, maybe if I am not sure. Oops. Yeah. Thank you. I mean, always technology makes sure we look like idiots. So, I mean, this is Brihadeshwara temple. And the Brihadeshwara, I'm sure maybe you might have heard of it. It's in Tanjavur. The whole temple was built after consecrating the main linga. It's about, I think, 20 or 30 feet huge linga. And similarly, if you see the bull itself is again about 20, 25 feet. And so the temple was built around. It is something like that. You take a mountain or it is like building a sculpture, cutting up, making a sculpture. You take a rock and then cut it down. So then you're always constrained by that material. So today, the largest semiconductor fabrication facility would have about 450 millimeter, maybe a handful of them. And some more would have 300 millimeter wafer capability, but again, that's again a few handful. You don't have hundreds of them. And India, as I said, is wonderfully about 10, 15 generation behind. Thankfully, 2 years back, we can do 8 inches. Otherwise, it was not even there, only in semiconductor complex Chandigarh. But then the modern day new material is, it's up to you to design. If you can think, you can build anything. So that is what the new material enables. So you, and one of the most exciting, so there are so many materials, amorphous, organic, metal oxides, carbon, amorphous, silicon, many materials. It's just beyond the scope now to talk of everything. I just want to maybe talk of, say, one material, like, say, carbon, which is very sustainable. Again, as I said, we have huge amount of environmental issues working with silicon and the gases and the chemicals that go along with it for processing. So if we could look at carbon, so the huge advantage is now you can make metals, semiconductors, insulators, polymers, all sorts of combination out of it, and scope is unlimited. And therefore, I mean, and again, not every, typically, I mean, so this is enabled by the bonding in the carbon material. I'll not go into the details of it, but then you can combine this bonding and create all sorts of variation. For example, every time a material is invented or discovered, before it became part of a core technology, earlier it used to take 3 to 4 decades or even more. But then this is one of the rare cases where 1991 carbon nanotube was, I mean, identified or discovered, and today so many technologies. This is a roadmap set up by some Japanese industry and academics in a forum, and every time they have been ahead of the roadmap. So various ways of growing this material. But then I just want to say a few minutes as to say how we could do things within ourselves. Let's talk about something called cathodic arc. This is a simple technology. I mean, and using this today, materials can be grown on any surface, any shape, meters together, from aircraft windows to implanting stents to, I mean, biocompatible or strong protective glasses. All sorts of application happen with carbon-based coatings, and they're biocompatible, environment friendly, and very useful. And this process, again, typically they were mainly used for protective applications or decorative application, but I have had the privilege of trying to make this copper or carbon at room temperature on plastic, glass, paper, and also try to use it for electronics. So, and plus, now we can develop all of this indigenously. We do not have to wait. For example, as I mentioned, SEL Chandigarh had to wait for, I mean, in mid-90s, they had a fire. The semiconductor complex was lost. But then we had to wait up to 2014 for the process to start again to come to an 8-inch wafer. So here, this is to mention that in the age of IoT, when sensors and systems, we showed a graph earlier, something which said Moore. Whole of a semiconductor industry was enabled by this Moore's law. Moore is reducing device dimension. That is supposed to be 20%. 80% of the future growth is on new material, new devices, newer application. And so that's what we would like to showcase that. See, earlier they were only using it for mechanical application or at the most conductive coatings. But now using a very simple process, you could bring two carbon electrodes or any metal electrodes, cause a discharge, bring out an atom. And in that, when the atom comes out of the discharge, it comes highly energized. You use that to do any interaction. Literally what could be done at 1500 now can be done at room temperature on any surface. And as not just in millimeters, but you could do over meters. I mean, as I said, helicopter windows, I mean, polypropylene windows are coated with maybe transparent conducting oxides, and over that, maybe again, a DLC coating to see that even if anything strikes, it will still not crack. So, I mean, that's the type of opportunities that cathodic arc gives. And for the sheer lack of time, I'll not go into detail. But these are showing some equipments that I have been involved in designing, and we have created many of these equipments even in India in multiple universities. Now they're using it. And from this, the key point I wanted to convey in this is whole of electronic industry All the properties are enabled by changing the transport in electronic material over 8 to 10 orders. I mean, that is what you change to make a conductor, insulator, diode, transistor, whatever. Combine this. We have been able to make atomic smooth films to clusters, fibers, pillar-like structures, and also in nano diamond incorporations to nanotube incorporation, all at room temperature by varying process parameter. And also even pattern them over large areas using things like nanosphere lithography for beer. And more, change the transport property over 12 orders. So anything that you could do with conventional semiconductor, you could do with a room temperature carbon, which could be subjected to standard semiconductor processing on glass, plastic, ceramic. You could make thin film transistors, diodes, and also something else called vacuum nanoelectronic device. Again, for the lack of time, I'll not go into detail, but essentially what it does is you make sure that you apply a high field to a sharp featured point. It gives electron into free space. The moment electron comes into free space, you can do many wonderful things. You can create lighting systems. You can have terahertz sources. You can make medical instrumentation, all sorts of things. So using this, I mean, this is just an example, satellite propulsion to lighting, to sensors, to even an X-ray source, which can go into a catheter, is compact. So we have also filed some patents and maybe approved of how to do some of this room temperature nanocarbon. And as a first example, conventionally what was done at 1000 degree, we have done with a room temperature and even a lighting system which uses less energy than LED. I mean, so it could be worked in a conventional glass bulb factory. A broken down glass bulb factory can be started again. So these are just to say that, and so this is an example of how some of these bulbs work, and we could again optimize and characterize everything with our custom designed equipments, and also show that there is something called resonant tunneling behavior. I'll not go boring you into all of this, but the key is that these are again future, a lot of electronic application can happen. Many process equipments designed indigenously, or even equipments for characterization, first of its type developed. But the key point is this new materials, emerging nanocarbon, or metal oxides or organic materials, you can bring them together. You can develop devices, you can make integrated circuits, and whole of this process equipment and even their characterization equipments can be built indigenously at a very suboptimal cost. What could be earlier done in billions of dollars could possibly happen now. And we need even to develop some of this software to do some of this design and development from atom level to integrated circuits. What Berkeley or others started earlier, this could be the type of opportunity the emerging materials offer to us. So it's up to us, faculty, students, industry, to join together and see that we make electronics from, I mean, I'm saying that from a billions of dollar industry to literally for the innovation for the age of IoT to be made here in our home or in literally in the garage next to us. But I hope students will make use of this opportunity and we all could work together. Thank you very much. Yeah.